Good morning. Welcome to Arlington Street Church, gathered in love and service for justice and peace. Welcome to the soul of Sunday. We are Unitarian Universalists. Ours is an historic faith with a progressive theology. We affirm the worth and dignity of every being, and that we are all deeply interconnected. We are bound to one another not by creed, but by covenant. And we are called to answer the call of love with open minds, open hearts, and open hands. Whoever you are, those of all nations, all creeds, all colors, all kinds of love, you are welcome here. Would our veterans in the Zoom room and in the sanctuary please rise as you're willing and able so we may recognize you. In 1918, at the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, the fighting officially ended. In a railroad car in the forest of Compiègne, France, Germany signed an armistice agreement with the Allies, marking the formal ending of World War I. I invite you to join me in a moment of silence as a sign of respect both for the approximately 37 million people who died in that war and for all those who have lost their lives in conflict since then, and for their loved ones. In honor of our veterans, let us rededicate ourselves to the peace of which they all dream. I invite you to join me in reading responsibly, If There Is to Be Peace. The words are in the order of the service and in the chat. I'll begin. If there is to be peace in the world, if there is to be peace in the nations, if there is to be peace in the cities, if there is to be peace between neighbors, if there is to be peace in the home. Amen.
Circle for the planet.
As we gather, we acknowledge that Arlington Street Church occupies the ancestral homeland of the Massachusetts. By making this land acknowledgement, we recognize, honor, and affirm the sovereignty of all First Nations peoples. Dear ones, welcome to our Zoomers, and welcome to the congregation gathered here in the sanctuary. Welcome to Roddy's friend, Abby McElroy, and his mom, Nancy Emily. Where are you, friends? We're so happy you're here. Great to see you. Welcome. Word has it that New Jersey is in the house. Woot! I just want to take a moment to welcome my beloved colleague, whom I haven't seen for so many years, the Reverend Dr. Robin Tanner. It is so lovely to have you here, my love. Thank you for coming. And coming of age groups. This is our congregations in Montclair and Summit, New Jersey, right? It's a joy to have you here. We're just thrilled you've come. Welcome, friends. Welcome. Our executive minister, Reverend Beth Robbins, is actually preaching across the river this morning to our congregation in Cambridge, Massachusetts. I want to say a very special thanks to our volunteers here in the sanctuary today. Tech team, Great Doors team, greeters and ushers, worship team, musicians, and the Arlington Street Church Choir, directed by Mark David Buckles. Thank you, friends. Following the guidance of the Boston Public Health Commission, we're continuing to mask and physically distance in the sanctuary. Please keep your mask over your nose and mouth the whole time you're inside to protect our most vulnerable spiritual companions. Thank you, friends. For those of you who are new to Arlington Street, a very special welcome to you. Those of you in the sanctuary, you'll find welcome cards in the pew racks. You can hand yours to an usher or to Queen Cheryl. She's the one in the tiara. Or you can drop it in the basket at the great doors as you leave. For those of you in the Zoom room, please fill out a connection card. The link is in the chat. It includes the option to request a link to a recording of today's sermon. Since we can't reach all of you in person after the service, Reverend Beth and I would love to invite you to an upcoming new friends gathering on Zoom. Whether you've been coming here for years or today is your first time at Arlington Street, welcome home.
Good morning.
Morning, Roddy.
If you haven't already downloaded today's order of service, it's available in the chat and on our homepage at ascboston.org. For everyone here in the sanctuary, there are printed copies at the great doors. Also on the homepage, you'll find a link to Sermon Bingo. Feel free to play along as Reverend Kim preaches. As we begin our greetings, I invite the Zoomers and those here in the sanctuary with a device handy to please say hello in the chat and tell us where you're Zooming in from. And now, Rich is going to turn the camera on the Incarnate congregation as we wave and smize at each other, as well as our friends here in the Zoom room. And you all in the Zoom room can wave and smile back. Hello, friends. Let's all engage that Arlington Street spirit of welcome that transcends physical distance as we greet one another heart to heart.
Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Mark David Buckles. I'm the director of music. Our first hymn today is called In the Shelter of Each Other. And it's a call and response song. And I'll sing a line and I'll have you sing it back to me. But you know, why don't we go ahead and rise in body, rise in spirit, get ourselves prepared for communal music making. So before we launch into the song, we'll give you a flavor of what we're dealing with. I'll sing a line, you sing it back. It goes like this. In the shelter.
In the shelter.
Of each other.
Of each other.
In the shelter.
In the shelter.
Of our lives.
Of our lives.
We are open.
We are open.
We are dreaming.
We are dreaming.
We are hopeful.
We are hopeful.
We are wise. Feel free to sing along to the whole song. All the words are printed in your order of service or are available in the chat. Add some harmony parts and let's sing together. In the shelter.
In the shelter.
Of each other.
Of each other.
In the shelter.
In the shelter.
Of our lives.
Of our lives.
We are open.
We are open.
We are dreaming.
We are dreaming.
We are hopeful.
We are.
We are wise.
We are wise.
Many times the weight of the world crashes in. We feel angry and afraid. We start to lose our sense of hope, our sense of direction. Isolation we have learned will not bring much in return if we truly cannot learn to live as one. Here we go. In the shelter.
In the shelter.
Of each other.
Of each other.
In the shelter.
In the shelter.
Of our lives. We are dreaming.
We are dreaming.
We are hopeful.
We are hopeful.
We are wise.
We are wise.
You know that many times the weight of the world crashes in. We feel broken and betrayed. We start to lose our sense of joy, our sense of connection. And though our history remains, it's our actions we must change. If we hope to heal our planet, we know that we must stand in the shelter,
in the shelter
of each other. In the shelter,
in the shelter
of our lives. Each other,
of each other,
in the shelter,
in the shelter
of our
lives. Of our lives.
We are open.
We are open.
We are dreaming.
We are dreaming.
We are hopeful.
We are hopeful.
We are wise.
We are wise.
We are wise. We are wise.
We are wise.
Amen.
Time for our treasured ritual of sharing community candles of sorrow and joy. These candles were submitted on our website by the Friday evening deadline. If you didn't submit your candle and have a joy or sorrow to share this morning, please wait until the third candle is lit, the silent candle, and then type your joy or sorrow in the chat. Zoomers are invited to light silent candles at home. Those in the sanctuary are invited to light a silent candle at the table up front to the right of the Gleason podium. In addition to sharing our joys and sorrows this morning, let's reach out to one another in the week ahead, staying connected. May these times remind us how very precious this beloved community is. We need one another. Whether together or apart, may we stay very close. And now, in the spirit of invocation, let's join in singing Sanctuary. The words are printed in your order of service and in the chat. One candle of sorrow this morning, a candle of sorrow for the ongoing intimidation of election officials across this country. We hold them in our hearts as they insist on fulfilling their sacred and critical role in the service of our democracy.
Some of us come today in joy. We share your joy.
We have one candle of joy this morning, a candle of joy at the extraordinary voter turnout in these midterm elections this past week. Let us count this as a great victory for our democracy in these times when it has been so sorely tested.
Joys we hold in our hearts, we light a silent candle to remember and to rejoice. May the peace of this sanctuary enter into our hearts as we share a quiet moment together, breathing our prayers for ourselves, for one another, for our country, and for the world.
Let's join now in saying together the affirmation and covenant of this beloved spiritual community. The words are printed in your order of service and in the chat. Love is the spirit of this congregation, and service is our gift. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to speak our truths in love, and to help one another.
El amor es el espíritu de nuestra congregación, y el servicio es nuestro regalo. Esto es a lo que nos comprometemos, convivir en paz, hablar nuestras verdades con amor, y ayudarnos los unos a los otros.
Our next hymn is another one you won't find in ye old hymnal. This is a song by Roberta Flack, who it's kind of a disco song in the original. Not going to be doing the disco version today. I actually learned it from Reverend Joanna Lubkin, who's sitting in the front row of the choir right now, who learned it from Isa Barnwell, is that right? Yeah, so I'm happy to pass it along to you. It's a lovely song. I did make one error in the order of service lyrics, which is that we keep singing about mountains and valleys and rivers, and every time we do that, we're gonna do them in that order, mountains, valleys, and meadows. And for some reason, my copy and paste got the wrong order some of the time. So, sorry for that confusion. I'm gonna sing you a line, sing it back to me, it goes like this. There's a river somewhere that flows through the lives of everyone. Try that with me. There's a river somewhere that flows through the lives of everyone. Next line goes, and it flows through the mountains and the valleys and the meadows of time. Try that, and it flows. And it flows through the mountains and the valleys and the meadows of time. Great, why don't we rise in body, rise in spirit. We'll sing this together. Again, feel free to add some harmonies. Move your body in a way that feels good to you. The chorus is just, yes it do, yes it do, yes it do. You'll pick it right up when we get there. Let's start with, there's a river. There's a river somewhere that flows through the lives of everyone. And it flows through the mountains and the valleys and the meadows of time. There's a star in the sky, it brightens the lives of everyone. And it brightens the mountains and the valleys and the meadows of time. Yes, it do. 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 Yes, it do, yes, it do, yes, it do, yes, it do. There's a voice, there's a voice from the past that speaks through the lives of everyone. And it speaks through the mountains and the valleys and the meadows of time. There's a smile in your eyes that brightens the lives of everyone. And it brightens the mountains and the valleys and the meadows of time. Yes, it do.
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Oh, yes, I do. 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 There's a sweet song of love that sweetens the lives of everyone. And it sweetens the mountains and the valleys, the meadows of time. There's a river somewhere that flows through the lives of everyone. And it flows through the mountains and the valleys and the meadows of time. Yes, I do. Oh, yes, I do. 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 Yes, I do.
Mahatma Gandhi and Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. are two of my greatest heroes. Though there are situations in which I lack the imagination to envision a different recourse, I tend hard to pacifism, regarding violence and war as a poor means of settling disputes. And so it's a stretch for me to find common ground with those whose first choice is to take up arms rather than their last resort. I have tremendous respect, though, for veterans, and am inspired by those who have served out of a deep sense of conviction and with honor. On this Veterans Day Sunday, I want to share four veteran stories as a lens on the concept of honor, which feels at once old-fashioned and, I'm convinced, is a sorely missing element of civil society. These words are from James Davison Hunter's The Death of Character. He writes, "We say we want a renewal of character, but to have a renewal of character is to have a renewal of creedal order that constrains, limits, binds, obligates, and compels. The price is high. We want character, but without unyielding conviction. We want strong morality, but without the emotional burden of guilt or shame. We want virtue, but without particular moral justifications that invariably offend. We want good without having to name evil. We want moral community without any limitations to personal freedom. In short, we want what we cannot possibly have on the terms that we want it." I invite you to join me in hearing these words as a challenge. Today's first veteran story is from Francis Whitebird, now 80 years old. Francis is a member of the Rosebud Sioux Tribe and a former commissioner of Indian Affairs in South Dakota. These are his words. I come from a warrior society. My great-grandfathers fought in the Battle of the Rosebud in 1876 and 8 days later in the Battle of Little Bighorn. My uncle fought in the trenches during World War I. My father was a Lakota code talker and fought in World War II's Battle of the Bulge. I graduated from university in 1967. I had never flown on an airplane or been to another country, but I enlisted in the Army, trained as a medic, and on March 20th, 1969, landed in Vietnam. When someone gets wounded in battle and yells, "Medic," we go. The other soldiers increase firepower while a medic drags the wounded person out of the line of fire. My job was to keep that guy alive until we could get him onto a helicopter. The casualty rate was very high. We went through 27 medics in the first 9 months I was in Vietnam. I wouldn't say that we were fearless, but we hid our fear. A firefight could last for a couple of days, or like the Hep Suk battle, for 13 straight days. I was wounded by shrapnel, but I had to keep going. There were lives to save. I earned a Purple Heart and got out of the military in 1970. 3 years later, I went to Harvard and earned a graduate degree in education. I had a successful career, but I also ended up with cancer. I tell my wife that Charlie, the Viet Cong, didn't kill me, but Agent Orange is killing me a little bit every day. Two of my sons, Colin and Brendan, have continued the tradition of service. Both were deployed to Iraq. I am so proud of them, just as I am of all who have fought for this country. Francis Whitebird, this is honor. Traditionally, honor means having a reputation worthy of admiration and respect. Originally, it might have been based on one's physical prowess. Ancient Greek philosophy wed bravery with character traits such as integrity, self-control, orderliness, industry, and dependability. In medieval times, chivalry was added in. And then, beginning in the 20th century, something happened. Honor seemed to unravel as the anonymity of urbanization dissolved that intimate face-to-face relationship that honor requires. Shame went out of vogue, which sometimes inspires honor when all else fails. And the worst of it, of course, are the ways in which an individual's needs and desires were elevated above the common good. At the same time, a shared agreement about what constitutes the common good was lost. Honor, once very public, became private at best. Here's a second story. Rhonda Cornum, 68 years old, is a surgeon living in Kentucky. She says, "In 1978, I was coming out of graduate school with a PhD in biochemistry. An Army recruiter contacted me and said, 'We need someone to do the research that you do. The only catch is that you have to join the Army.' I saw the lab in San Francisco where I'd be working, and it was beautiful. So I joined. But after 4 years, I realized I was making half as much as the physician, so I went to the Army Medical School and became a flight surgeon. On August 2nd, 1990, I watched TV as Iraqi tanks rolled into Kuwait. The commander of a helicopter battalion asked me to go with his unit to Iraq. I remember thinking, I could die. My grandfather was a World War II vet. He once told me, 'Rhonda, there are worse things than dying. There is living with dishonor. If I didn't go, I would have to live with that dishonor for the rest of my life.' I thought, 'You're really going to war, Rhonda?' On February 27, 1991, I was aboard a Black Hawk helicopter on a search and rescue mission over southern Iraq. An F-16 pilot had ejected from his plane. He was alive and talking on his radio. We went to get him, but didn't have intel. All we had were coordinates. In fact, we were headed into the biggest ammunition supply point in southern Iraq. We were shot down. Five guys from my aircraft died. I was lucky, but I was wounded. I had two broken arms, a broken finger, and a gunshot wound in my back. After regaining consciousness, my first thought was, nobody's ever died from pain. I ended up a prisoner of war. After 8 days, I was repatriated. And after a few surgeries to heal me up, the fact that I was a woman, the fact that I had served on the front lines and that I had become a prisoner of war gave me a lot of credibility to speak up. Dr. Radha Kornman did speak up and went on to be the Army's Assistant Surgeon General for Force Protection. Reviving honor begins at the highest point of spiritual awakening. When we realize that the world does not revolve around us, that there is a higher moral imperative than personal pleasure and gain, that every choice we make affects those around us, in a way affects everyone. We stop doing things out of fear of retribution, stop doing the bare minimum, and are motivated not by duty for duty's sake, but by a higher imperative, that seventh principle of Unitarian Universalism, respect for the interdependent web of all existence. In his book, The Way of Men, speaker and author Jack Donovan writes, part of the reason that honor is a virtue rather than merely a state of affairs is that respect for your peers is a show of loyalty and an indication of belonging. Honor moves us from acting out of fear of authority to acting from love, the highest calling. My third story is from 93-year-old George B. Price. He says, I have to give credit to my hometown of Laurel, Mississippi. We were raised to believe that service to one's country was an honorable and dignified profession. We had African-American veterans of World War I living there, so we had role models. It was a community spirit. Everybody felt a part of it, including my sister, Leontine Price, who went on to become the famous opera singer. I first left home for university on a football scholarship, but I was fully determined to become a military officer. In the summer after my junior year, this was during the period when President Truman signed the desegregation order for the armed forces, we were training in Georgia, where there were strict segregation laws. It was difficult, but we focused. We worked through it. When I graduated, the Army was not only desegregating, but deploying to a war zone, the Korean Peninsula. From the day I put on the uniform, I felt it was my job to perform above and beyond the call of duty. So that's what I did. I was in combat nearly every day I was in Korea. I was wounded and spent 6 months in the hospital in Virginia. I went to airborne school. I went to Army Ranger school. I embedded with the South Vietnamese Army during the Vietnam War and served as an advisor to them. My obligation was to be the best officer I could in service to my country and to the soldiers whom I led. That's what had been instilled in me as a kid by my community and my mentors. In 1976, I became chief of staff of the United States Army. Honor is self-reinforcing. Each honorable act builds on a conviction of self-worth. It checks narcissism, binding those who behave honorably in mutual respect for what's best, not only for individuals, but for the greater good. All honorable behavior comes down to just that, taking into account the larger community and choosing not to engage in behavior that will in any way weaken it. In contemporary society, as the bonds of honor have dissolved, we've come to rely on obedience to ever more elaborate rules and regulations to govern behavior, doing the right thing, whether or not someone is watching, has been replaced by surveillance cameras to reinforce ethical behavior. But honor can be revived. Whether or not honor can be revived on a society-wide culture, we can revive it in our own lives and in the life of our community, and so build beloved community. Today's fourth and final veteran story is told by 58-year-old Quang Pham, founder and CEO of a biopharmaceutical company and author of A Sense of Duty. In March of 1965, the United States ordered combat troops into the war. My father was a lieutenant colonel in the South Vietnamese Air Force. I had been born about 6 months earlier. 10 years later, when Saigon fell and the North Vietnamese overran the whole area, I had just finished fifth grade. At 2 o'clock in the morning of April 22nd, 1975, evacuations began. We were on the second flight, my mother, my three sisters, and I. I remember big, tall Americans helping us onto the C-130, and I can still hear the sound of the thundering engines. My father remained behind and became a military prisoner. We lost touch with him. He was my hero, and I had dreams of becoming a military pilot like him. My family ended up in California. I went to UCLA to study economics. One day, a Marine recruiter was on campus and invited me to go to officer candidate school. I showed up in Virginia in 1986. The biggest shock was how much the Vietnam War was still on the minds of the US military. There were a lot of racist slurs. But there was no way I wasn't going to make it through. When I got to my squadron in 1990, the Gulf War began. I volunteered to go. In Saudi Arabia, I was a new co-pilot aboard a CH-46 Sea Knight helicopter, the second youngest pilot in my squadron. On February 27, 1991, we flew the first medical evacuation out of Kuwait, 50 feet off the desert floor, the fields below us in flames. In May of 1992, as I was getting ready for my second deployment, my father arrived in America. It had been 17 years since I'd last seen him wearing a flight suit. He was finally free, and I was wearing a flight suit. We were united, and my life had come full circle. 3 days later, I deployed to the Persian Gulf and then to Mogadishu, Somalia. People couldn't understand my drive to serve. It was my way to pay it back to this country and my honor. Beloved spiritual companions, on this Veterans Day Sunday, let us cherish the memory of those who have gone before us with honor. May we hear the challenge to revive honor and so enchant civil society with a passion for the common good. May we answer the spiritual call to live deeply into our interconnectedness. And may all that we do be done in love, our highest calling. So may we build the beloved community. Amen.
They wouldn't hear your music, and they pulled your paintings down. They wouldn't hear your writing, and they banned you from the town. And they couldn't stop you dreaming, and a victory you did win. For you sowed the seeds of freedom in your children and your kin, in your children and your kin. Your children and your kin. You sowed the seeds of freedom in your children and your kin.
Your weary smile, it proudly hides the chain marks on your hands as you bravely strive to realize the rights of everyone. And though your body's bent and low, a victory you did win. For you sowed the seeds of justice in your children and your kin. In your children and your kin. Your children and your kin. You sowed the seeds of justice in your children and your kin.
I don't know your religion, but one day I heard you pray for a world where everyone can work and children they can play. And though you never got your share of the fruits that you did win, you sowed the seeds of equality in your children and your kin, in your children and your kin. Your children and your kin. You sowed the seeds of equality in your children and your
taunted you in Belfast, they tortured you in Spain, and in that Warsaw ghetto where they tied you up in chains. In Vietnam and Chile, where they came with tanks and guns, it's there you sow the seeds of peace in your children and your kin. In your children and your kin.
your children and your kin. 'Cause there you sowed the seeds of peace in your children and your kin. And now your music's playing and your writing's on the wall, and all the dreams you've painted can be seen by one and all. Now you've got them thinking, and the future can begin. For you sowed the seeds of freedom in your children and your kin, in your children and your kin, your children and your kin. You sowed the seeds of freedom in your children and your kin.
Thanks, Mark, David, and Julie. That was really beautiful. Friends, Arlington Street is entirely self-sustaining. It's up to us. And our generosity continues to be astounding. Thank you for your commitment to our staff, our building, and our beloved spiritual community. Each Sunday, we share our collection plate with a partner in our mission of love, justice, service, and peace. For three Sundays of this month, our beneficiary will be Only a Child, founded in Guatemala in 1994 by Arlington Street member George Ledger. Our gifts will support the Only a Child home and sponsor tuition at high quality secondary schools and universities for youth from impoverished backgrounds. Thank you for your generosity. This year, I'm a junior at Harvard, majoring in social studies. And this past summer, I spent in Washington, D.C., serving as an intern in Senator Jeanne Shaheen's office from the home state of New Hampshire. Over this past month, however, I've been going home to New Hampshire on the weekends, volunteering and door knocking to help get the vote out. I joined Arlington Street earlier this year, and I love being part of a faith tradition that calls us to participate in our democratic process and holds it as sacred. It's wonderful to be here with all of you today. Please take a moment now to join me in giving to our beloved spiritual community and filling out our virtual collection plate. You can give online by scanning the QR code in the order of service or by going to ascboston.org. You can also mail a check to the church or use the envelopes in the pews, which can be handed to Rev Kim or me after the service or to any of the ushers. You can also give, text your gift to the church by sending a message with the word give, G-I-V-E, to 617-300-0509. Thank you for your generosity.
Thank you, Roddy. Well, just a little shout out to Julie Metcalf, who you've already heard play a million things. Violin, tambourine, gonna play some djembe singing, and another instrument which maybe you didn't even know she played, we're gonna feature in this next song. How many roads must a man walk down before you can call him a man? Yes, and how many seas must a white dove sail before she sleeps in the sand? Yes, and how many times must the cannonballs fly before they're forever banned? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. Feel free to sing this along with me if you know it. How many years can a mountain exist before it is washed to the sea? Yes, and how many years can some people exist before they're allowed to be free? Yes, and how many times can a man turn his head, pretending he just doesn't see? The answer, my friends, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. How many times can a man look up before he can see the sky? Yes, and how many ears must one man have before he can hear people cry? Yes, and how many deaths will it take till he knows that too many people have died? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
Thank you, Mark, David, and Julie. Friends, there are weekly gatherings in the Zoom room for loving kindness meditation, poetry, yoga, and writing. This Tuesday evening, both our governing boards, the Prudential Committee, and the Transformation Team for Racial Justice host their monthly open meetings. Every Wednesday, Rev Kim and Rev Beth host a tea party with a conversation prompt. This week's prompt is Before I Die, I Want, fill in the blank. This Wednesday evening, all interested newcomers are warmly welcome to a new member class. You'll learn a little of Arlington Street's illustrious history and meet some of our wonderful leadership. This is a great opportunity to deepen your knowledge of our beloved spiritual community and to discern whether you might be ready to formally join. And Mark David has a special announcement for us as well.
In honor of Thanksgiving next Sunday, we have a special service. We do a special service the weekend before Thanksgiving because we know some of us head to places afar on that Thanksgiving weekend. So we do a big shebang the weekend before. And this year it is just a lovely Bach cantata, cantata 196. We'll have a small string orchestra here. This little thing under this cloth here is actually a small organ, which gets rolled out to the center, and we just have really beautiful, resplendent music about gratitude and blessings, and I hope you'll join us then.
Can't wait. And another early reminder that next Sunday afternoon, our Transformation Team for Racial Justice will be holding a drop-in informational meeting about Arlington Street's involvement in Beloved Conversations, a Unitarian Universalist anti-racism educational program. Information and Zoom links are at ascboston.org. To attend any of these meetings, you don't have to be an official member, you don't have to turn on your video or talk if you don't want to, and they're all free. All are always welcome. Following the service, everyone is welcome to join the virtual coffee hour. If you'd like to participate, please answer yes to the breakout Zoom room invitation that will appear on your screen. If you're here in the sanctuary, you'll need to go to the Zoom room before the postulate begins. If you're zooming in from out of state, Marie O'Brien, Martha Bonney, and Rebecca Geeky are hosting the Come From Away Zoomers in the breakout room today. The conversation prompt is, what is one thing you're grateful for right now? Please chat chem/techteam if you'd like to join them. Rev Kim will also be out front after the service for those folks here in the sanctuary. If you're here in person, after virtual coffee hour, please come say hello and linger and visit on the sidewalk. Thanks to all who've made today possible and joined in today's service, and to all who are here today. Remember, we're all in this together.
Reverend Joanna Lubkin is the interim minister serving our congregation in West Roxbury and is an affiliated community minister here at Arlington Street. Welcome, Rev Jo. Thank you.
Delighted to share a closing hymn with you. It's one of my favorites, one of the things I sing to myself when integrity and honor is called for and I need to summon it. This is Let the Life I Lead. I'm going to teach it real quick because it's not in our hymnals. I'll sing a line and invite you to sing it back to me.
Let the life I lead speak for me.
Let's do that together.
Let the life I lead speak for me.
Here's the second part.
Let the life I lead speak for me. Let the life I lead speak for me. When I come to the end of the road and I lay down my heavy load, when I come to the end of the road and I lay down my heavy load, let the life I lead speak for me. Let the life I lead speak for me.
Beautiful. I invite you to rise in body and spirit and raise your voices together. We'll call out other verses as we go. Let the life.
Let the life I lead speak for me. Let the life I lead speak for me. When I the friends I have speak for me. Let the friends I have speak for me. When I come to the end of the road and I lay down my heavy load,
the friends I have,
friends I have speak for me. The work I do, let the work I do speak for me. Let the work I do speak for me. When I come to the end of the road and I lay down my heavy load, let the work I do I share, let the love I share speak for me. Let the love I share speak for me. When I come to the end of the road and I lay down my heavy load, the love I share, love I share, speak for me. The songs I sing, let the songs I sing speak for me. Let the songs I sing speak for me.
songs I sing. Songs I sing speak for me, the life I lead. Let the life I lead speak for me. Let the life I lead speak for me. When I come to the end of the road and I lay down my heavy load, let the life I lead speak for me.
Bravo. Before our benediction, I invite those of you in the Zoom room to please reach out your hands and touch the sides of your square. Those of you in the sanctuary to please raise your hands, palms out. Let's send loving kindness to the people to your left and to your right. Send loving kindness to the person on either side of you, to the people on either side of them. Send out love into this beloved spiritual community and feel it coming back to you. Love is the spirit of this congregation. And now for our benediction, I invite you to put your hand over your heart in namaste. I bow to the divine in you. From Tolstoy's War and Peace, I say, let us join with those who love goodness and let there be only one banner, real goodness. I want to say that it is always the simplest ideas that lead to the greatest consequences. My idea in its entirety is that if vile people unite and constitute a force, then decent people are obliged to do likewise. Just that. Long live the whole world. Let us keep this faith, beloveds, and pass it on. The service begins when the service ends. Bless your hearts. I love you. Amen.
please visit ascboston.org for more information about this historic Unitarian Universalist congregation. Arlington Street Church, gathered in love and service for justice and peace.